references to sponsorship or any kind of guide in other than God, you know, because most of the time you'll see how he's asking God for guidance. And right here is a reference to another human being. He says, God alone can judge our sex situation. However, counsel with persons is often desirable, but we let God be the final judge. We realize that some people are as fanatical about sex as others are loose. We avoid hysterical thinking or advice. You know, that's one of the ideas that I've adopted from someone who was teaching me the steps when I used to, you know, when I first started sponsoring people. And it was going on quite a bit. I had gone to NA meetings before, and there's a lot of this going on in other programs, you know, out there, is that someone who has time in sobriety, you know, 15, 10, 15, 20 years, is seen as like some kind of guru, and then the new guy comes in and thinks that this other person has the ability to give them direction in their life and thinks, hey, you got more time than me. Tell me what should I do about these specific matters in my life. And there was a lot of that going on when I got sober, so I fell into it too. When my sponsees would call me, I'd tell them exactly what they should do about their problems. And then I later, you could see in the fourth step where he says, we avoid hysterical thinking or advice. We realize that other people are as fanatical about sex as others are loose. And then he's got on the other page here, we have the voices who cry for sex and more sex, and people who bewail the institution of marriage, who think that most troubles, and then we got the people who, you know, think that the sex is a base necessity of procreation. So you've got these two opposite ends of the spectrum as far as, you know, any ideals about not just sexual behavior, but all your behavior. Some people might think it's okay to, you know, be a little dishonest every once in a while. Maybe, you know, pull up to a parking meter that's got time left on it and use that time. And then someone else might say, oh, you know, you can't do that. It's dishonest. And some people are just, you know, just hardcore honest about every little. They won't even, you know, if someone asks them flat out something they should lie about, they won't lie about it. And, you know, even when it says except when to do so would injure them or others, but some people, and I later found that it's not right to give that kind of advice to people, and it was taught to me by someone who I think is very smart, and he said, what you can do, you see, they're looking for advice. Somebody is going to call you as a sponsee on the phone, is going to say, what should I do about this specific matter? And it's very easy to let your ego take over and say, oh, I know exactly what you should do about that. But the hard thing is to turn them to God. It's the right thing to do also. And through the steps, take whatever problem it is they call you with and tell them how to apply the steps to it on the basis that it will be based in anger, fear, or guilt that they're feeling. Anything that they're experiencing will fall into one of those three categories. And all I have to do from now on is figure out which, maybe even all three of them sometimes, one, two, and all three of those will fall into those. It'll fall into all three of those categories. So when someone calls me and says, I got a problem, I take them straight to the fourth step inventory. Step five, admit it. Step six and seven, ask God to remove it and help me with it. Steps eight and nine, make any amends if you've done it. And step 12, turn your attention to helping others. That's the solution for everything that they'll call me with. And that's, I think, what he's talking about here. When he's talking about we let God be the final judge, counsel with other persons is often desirable. I think that you could fit anything into that category. And we're talking about sex, sexual behavior here, but you could say the same thing about honesty or dishonesty. Like, you know, maybe you found a bag of money on the side of the road and you can't tell who it belongs to, you know. There's no name. If you walk up to anybody and go, hey, did you lose a bag of money? Everybody's going to go, yeah, I lost a bag of money, you know. So now what do you do with a bag of money? You know, you take it to the cops. My personal opinion is if there ain't no sign of whose money it is, it's now your money. But some people say, oh, you got to take it to the cops. There's a guy down at the cop station right now looking for a bag of money, and you got his bag of money or something, you know. And you can't get into something like that. It's between each individual and their God of their understanding as to what to do about something like that. And you can take any situation in your life and fall into that category of this group over here thinks it's, you know, oh, you're doing the wrong thing, and that group thinks you're doing the right thing. It's between them and God. I think the selfishness, the two ideas of selflessness and selfishness are the best filter for everything that comes down the pike. And he says also, suppose we fall short of a chosen ideal and stumble. Does this mean we're going to get drunk? Obviously, we're in the sex inventory, and you could apply this to just about any area of your life. But, okay, let's say he says, suppose we fall short of the chosen ideal and stumble. obviously, then there's something you've done with your sexual partner, and she doesn't know about you've cheated on her again, or you've got some money out of the bank account and did something with it you shouldn't have done or whatever. Suppose this mean does this mean we're going to get drunk? Some people tell us so, but this is only a half truth. It depends on us and our motives. If we are sorry for what we have done and have the honest desire to let God take us to better things, we believe we will be forgiven and we will have learned our lesson. If we are not sorry and our conduct continues to harm others, we are quite sure to drink. We are not theorizing. These are the facts out of our experience. So in other words, if I do something and I go, you know what, to hell with her. To hell with her. Screw her. Who is she? If I say something like that, then it's not a good sign. But if I say something like, man, I shouldn't have done that. I got to make amends for that. I got to come clean. I got to go clean this mess up because this is going to haunt me. This is going to haunt me for days, weeks, or months, or whatever. And I might drink over this. Then I'm on the right path. But the fact that I've hurt someone else, the fact that I've hurt someone that I know, is not going to be the deciding factor as to whether I drink or not. Whether I drink or not depends upon my motives behind it. Am I truly sorry for what I did? Or am I just thinking, Big Brother's watching, I better do this or they're going to find out? Because in my heart, I can tell you that I would say I want to straighten this out because I know it's the right thing to do. To sum up about sex, we earnestly pray for the right ideal. Obviously, that's a reference to step 11. In step 11, we're going to pray for the right ideal, for guidance in each questionable situation, for sanity and for the strength to do the right thing. If sex is very troublesome, and many people use this next sub-paragraph, these next two or three lines, as it's almost a description of the whole 12 steps. It's a description of the idea behind the 12 steps. You could say, if anger is very troublesome, I throw myself the harder into helping others. If fear is very troublesome, I throw myself the harder into helping others. Or you could even erase sex and just put self. If selfishness is very troublesome, I throw myself the harder into helping others. I think of their needs and work for them. This takes us out of ourselves. It quiets the imperious urge when to yield would mean heartache. And that is essentially the most basic principle of Alcoholics Anonymous. The whole reason for the 12 steps is to find what's blocking me from actually genuinely thinking about other people. I think of their needs and work for them. This takes me out of myself, and it quiets. So here he's saying that this imperious urge is quieted by helping others, thinking of others, working for others, throwing myself the harder into helping others, quiets the imperious urge, which is obviously a reference to that the thought of the first drink that creeps back into my head. That first drink is rooted. This imperious urge is driven by fear, and all fear is based in self. There's nothing that you could be afraid of that is not based in self. I've never been afraid for somebody else. I was always afraid that I was going to. If I was afraid for someone else, it was because somewhere along the line I was going to lose something that was important to me. I was never afraid that they were going to feel pain, that they were going to suffer. I was always afraid that I was going to lose someone that was close to me. If we have been thorough about our personal inventory, we've written down a lot. Now, this is the summary of the fourth step, and in this summary, he's going to tell us the spiritual solutions here. A brief glance at them, if you'll look at them. We've written down a lot. We have listed and analyzed our resentments. We have begun to comprehend their futility and their fatality. We have commenced to see their terrible destructiveness. We have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill toward all men. And this is a reference to that forgiveness there. When he says, we have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill toward all men, even our enemies, for we look on them as sick people. That's definitely one of the phrases he uses in the directions for how to forgive. For we see them just like ourselves, they're sick. They're trying to find their way too. And we have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. That's a reference to making amends. When we're feeling guilty for our actions, we make amends to clear that guilt out of the way, because this anger and this guilt is what's blocking us from thinking of others and throwing ourselves harder into helping others and working for them, and takes us out of our imperious urge, quiets the imperious urge. In this book, we read again and again that faith did for us what we could not do for ourselves. So it's essentially, what is it that we say we could not do for ourselves? we couldn't say no to the first drink. That faith is what's going to combat this. That faith is the combat of that that imperious urge. That's a reference to faith in God. When you see him say, we throw ourselves the harder into helping others, we think of their needs and work for them, this takes us out of ourselves. It quiets that imperious urge when to yield would mean heartache. That is a reference to step 12, and that is a reference to faith in God. We hope you are now convinced that God can remove whatever self-will has blocked you off from him. Now, obviously, that's a pretty deep statement there. Am I convinced? We hope you are now convinced that God can remove whatever self-will has blocked you off from him. If you have already made a decision in that third step back there and an inventory of your grosser handicaps, you have made a good beginning. That being so, you have swallowed and digested some big chunks of truth about yourself. So, in the fourth step, we found those four most common three most common manifestations of self that block us from receiving and doing God's will. They were resentment, fear, and the guilt from the lists of the harms done others and harms done others sexually. We've seen references to the spiritual solutions on how to get rid of those, forgiveness, faith in God, and making amends. And even the fifth step has been referenced in here. The fifth step was referenced on... The fifth step was referenced on page 67 toward the bottom down there, the second full paragraph, the bottom of that paragraph. He says, we admitted our wrongs honestly, that's a reference to step 5, and we're willing to set these matters straight, is a reference to steps 8 and 9. Even though he only says willing, we were willing to set these matters straight. we've seen... If we follow directions, we can see that step 6 and 7 are the steps where we ask God to remove those things. So any reference to forgiveness was a reference to 6 and 7. And any reference to faith in God, getting out of ourselves, was a reference to the chapter with working with others, step 12. And the amends of the ninth step are outlined on page 76 through 84. There's like nine pages of the ninth step out there. When we get out there, we'll go over those. So we are also convinced, you see what he says, we hope you are now convinced that God can remove whatever self-will. If you'll remember back in the third step, he said the first requirement of the third step is that we be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly, on 60 in the page 60 at the bottom of the page there, the top of that last paragraph down there. The first requirement of the third step is that we be convinced that any life run on self-will can hardly be a success. And on that basis, we are almost always in collision with something or somebody, even though our motives are good. And that's what he's making a reference to when he says, we hope you are now convinced that God can remove. So that's one of the things we got from the fourth step. How to do the inventory in steps 10 and 11. This is going to be the same inventory. And it's going to be the same spiritual solutions. It's just the time frame that 4 is like your past, and step 10 will be step 10 and 11 will be your daily inventory that you do based on your experience with the past inventories. Chapter 6, into action. We'll get a couple of paragraphs in here. Okay, so having made our personal inventory, what shall we do about it? ? We have been trying to get a new attitude, a new relationship with our Creator, and to discover the obstacles in our path. Let's see, we have been trying to get a new attitude, a new relationship with our Creator. I guess you might say that would be like, you know, step 3, I made a decision to turn my will and my life over to the care of God, a reference to the third step, and to discover the obstacles in our path in step 4. We have admitted certain defects and have ascertained in a rough way what the trouble is. We have put our finger on the weak items in our personal inventory. Now these are about to be cast out. And this requires action on our part. And remember that action is, each one of those spiritual solutions does have action in them. Faith in God, I mean, that's obviously, how can I be of, it takes us out of ourselves, we work for others, we think of their needs, that's the reference he made. That's the work in faith in God. The work in making a